Hey, welcome back to the Personality Hacker Podcast. My name is Joel Mark Witt.
And I'm Antonia Dodge. And this week we're going to continue our series of deep dives into each of the 16 Myers-Briggs personality types. And today we're going to focus on the INTJ personality type.
Now, you might know in our genius system, the INTJ is called Perspectives Effectiveness Personality. But obviously in the Myers-Briggs system, it's an INTJ. And today we want to unpack, we want to demonstrate some of the mental wiring of the INTJ mind, but really get into some of the challenges and a deep dive into some of the things that may trip you up as an INTJ. If you have an INTJ in your life, these are some things to look for. But if you're an INTJ, we want to really give you some strategies and tools to be able to be more effective in the world as your personality type.
Right. Well, what's nice about this particular podcast is that we have the benefit of having the responses from a survey that we sent out. Now, we've sent out these surveys for every type that we're focusing in on for that particular week. And we received how many INTJ surveys?
It was over 150 within a few days.
Yeah, it was crazy. And what was nice about it is that we got to hear from people who identify with the INTJ personality type. We got to hear some of their major struggles, some of the things that they wish they had known when they were younger, some of the most powerful books and movies and experiences and resources, like the things that have impacted them the most. And we also got to hear what they wish other people knew about them. So it was quite a bit of information, and it helped clarify some things that we had already suspected. It also gave us a bit of a reframe on how people of this type can see themselves. One answer that came up in the survey I thought was brilliant. It was actually from an INTJ woman who said that even before she knew she was an INTJ, she had always identified with the Greek mythological character of Cassandra. Now, Cassandra was Apollo, the Greek god Apollo, attempted to seduce Cassandra by giving her the gift of prophecy. But when she spurned him and wouldn't allow herself to be seduced by him, then he cursed her and said, "Well, I'm going to let you keep the gift of prophecy, but I'm going to curse you and say that nobody's ever going to believe you. So you're going to know what's going to come up, but you can't do anything about it." And she said that that was sort of an encapsulation of how, like, basically the story of her life. And I thought that was such a great metaphor for what a lot of INTJs experience, which is this ability to see what's coming down the line and not feeling like anybody really cares. Nobody's really listening to the gift of foresight that they have is giving them. Now, foresight is different than prophecy. And, prophecy is a concept that you know for a certainty what's coming up, whereas foresight and insight is merely being able to project into the future and have some pattern recognition. But there is definitely a gift that people of this type have around foresight and being able to see, you know, what we call where the puck is going, which is a hockey metaphor for not skating to the puck, but skating to where you project the puck to be headed. And there's sort of a just basic strategy of life that INTJs have, which is where's the puck going? That's what they've always got their eye on, and that's where they're projecting. Or their projections take them is what's coming down the line. And they're not always honored for this gift. People don't always want to either hear it or they see it as magical, and so they don't give it the credibility it probably should have. And so it's a major struggle. It's basically kind of like we talked about with the INTPs. The greatest gift an INTP gives is the gift of radical honesty. Well, who wants that? Nobody wants radical honesty. I mean, we do. Our inner wisdom says we want it. And yet at the same time, when we get it, we're kind of like, oh, well, could you say it in a nicer way? It's kind of similar with an INTJ. One of the gifts that they bring to the world, one of their greatest gifts and strengths and talents, is something that the world is not particularly keen on listening to, because that means now we have to make changes. That means that now we have to alter how we're doing things, because maybe we're doing things in a non-sustainable way. So there's a lot of stress and a lot of, I think, just general sense of cynicism that comes along with recognizing that people don't always listen to what an INTJ would describe as one of their greatest strengths that they give to the world.
Yeah, I think we also got a lot of feedback based on that. I think some of the challenges that INTJs were reporting were things like isolation, loneliness, feeling like no one really, they didn't have anyone that got them at their level, and they were just by themselves in seeing some of this stuff. And it caused a sense of separation from others. And I think a lot of INTJs struggle with this, you know, based on what we know about INTJs already and based on these survey results. It's a lot of this feeling like either people are, they're not at your level as an INTJ to be able to spar with you intellectually. And that's not like they're stupid people. They just don't think the way you do. And so you feel isolated and lonely around that. And then you also have the challenge of you're able to see things about how the world works and where things are going, other people can't see. So there's like an intellectual element of it. And then there's also this idea of just being able to pattern recognize and use your intuition to foresee what's coming down the pike. And I think that causes, I think it causes a lot of pain for INTJs. They feel like they're alone in all of this. So today, I think we want to talk about some of these challenges. We want to talk about some of the things that you as an INTJ might be dealing with and get into some diagnosis and prescription of what we think will help you become a better version of yourself. And before we do that, I think it would be really good just to give a quick overview for the INTJ that's listening right now that would like to understand how their mind is wired.
Yeah. Is it okay if I make a comment before we go into the cognitive functions or the mental processes for this type? One thing that I want to mention is something that I've been seeing in feedback over and over based on an article that I wrote on INTJs, which in that article, I mentioned that INTJs are some of the quote unquote, the smartest people in the room based on analytical and linguistic intelligence. And I've seen quite a few INTJs take umbrage with me calling them, you know, one of the smartest IQ, you know, using IQs and traditional standards of intelligence. They take umbrage with this idea that they might be smarter than other people. And I'm not sure why, because if you get an INTJ to tell you some of their woes, they will say that they feel like a lot of people, like you mentioned, Joel, are not at their level. And so I think the clarification here, the thing that really kind of separates where there might be a disconnect with how an INTJ feels about being smarter and then not smarter at the same time, is that we as a society have decided different criteria for intelligence, and I don't think we're right. We did a podcast on Howard Gardner's multiple intelligences, and that's a philosophy I hold very strongly to. I believe that there are multiple different styles of intelligence, and all of them bring something very important to the world. And there are ways in which INTJs are massively outclassed by other types in different styles of intelligence, including introspective intelligence and kinesthetic intelligence and, you know, sometimes naturalistic, etc. So they're not the smartest people in the room, full stop. However, INTJs are very careful thinkers. They spend a lot of time thinking about whatever has captured their attention. And they have a lot of intellectual integrity, which as an ENTP, my personality type, I very much admire that. So in one of the ways in which they are quote unquote smarter than everybody else is maybe not even like raw computing power, although they can be that too. I think it's the carefulness of thought that they bring to the table. And because they're careful with how they think, for the most part, I mean, obviously, we're assuming the INTJ is at a relative level of health here. If you're an unhealthy, it doesn't matter what type you are, you're probably not going to show up being careful about anything. But if you're a healthy INTJ, you're going to be very careful about what you say, about how you're thinking. You're not going to jump to conclusions. You're going to want to be very thorough. And so by the time you get to that point of actually articulating what you're thinking, yeah, you're going to show up as one of the smartest people in the room simply because you put a lot of energy and brain wattage into whatever ended up being spoken by you. And so in that way, oftentimes you show up as quote unquote the smartest person in the room. That doesn't necessarily mean that you have higher computing qualities than others in the room, but it means that you're going to have gone through the steps to get to a more careful conclusion than other people in the room as a general rule. And I've noticed that as an ENTP, when I talk to INTJs, that is one of the greatest gifts that they've given me is an encouragement to be more careful with how I think. So I wanted to make that clear before we launch into this so that an INTJ listening to this that might take umbrage with that concept, that they're not taking umbrage, that they understand what we're trying to say here. Not that you're just smarter than everybody else, but I think most INTJs would agree that they are very careful in how they think. And so anytime you hear us make a reference to that, that's what we're referring to. We're referring to that cautiousness and that carefulness of thought.
Yeah, I think that rigor, that carefulness of thought, that that allows the INTJ to show up to the world very intelligent. This means they put more thought into the subject they're talking about. I don't believe INTJs have a habit of speaking when they haven't thought about something that they're working with. I think INTJs spend a lot of time percolating information, thinking about it deeply, like you're talking about, Antonia. And then when they present an idea, it's been thought through. And so it's very rare they run into someone else who says, oh, and have you thought about this? And they haven't thought about that, because they have spent every possible like iteration scenario. They've gone through every possible conclusion, that every if and then statement. Okay, well, if this worked this way, then this worked. And they've gotten rigorous about sorting out all of this in their own mind. And then they articulate it to the world. And they, you know, I'll be in a conversation with an INTJ and I'll say, well, what about this? And they're like, yeah, that's kind of stupid. Don't, like, I've already thought about that. That won't work. And I'm like, well, why not? And I'm like, I just heard it for the first time. So I'm idea generating in real time. And the INTJ has already thought through some of this. And so I think they get discouraged because it seems like to an INTJ that other people are stupid or they're not at their level of thought. And they aren't stupid, but they're right. They're not at their level of thought. I haven't put as much rigor into my thoughts when I'm talking to an INTJ about the subject that we're talking about as the INTJ most likely has. They've probably spent a lot more time letting it just sit in their intuition, in their unconscious, mulling it over, and then they articulate it. I've just started this process. So my stuff's going to sound very
embryonic,
inferior, and it could potentially look like I'm stupid when I'm talking about this. And I'm a very intelligent, intuitive person, and so are you. And if that looks like, if an INTJ is talking to us and that's the case, can you imagine if they talk to someone who isn't, you know, highly intuitive, doesn't like to talk about abstract things? It's probably even more maddening for them. So this could be like a double maddening scenario for you as an INTJ listening. You're like, man, I just feel like I turn around and everywhere I look, I find idiots around me. And I know that they can't be fully idiots, but they just don't think. Why don't they think for a change? Like, just take the time to be thoughtful people.
Well, and I think that that's a great segue into how an INTJ's mind is wired. Because we all have a certain amount of energy that we allocate to different things, different skills, tools, you know, talents. We all allocate our energy to different things. And for an INTJ, because of how they're wired, they choose to spend a lot of those energetic credits, so to speak, in the process of thinking, in processing information, in post-processing information. That's where they spend a ton of their energetic credits. And that's one of the reasons why they show up so physically, energetically conservative, right? Because they don't really tend to be high energy people. They don't tend to be, you know, emotive. They're not doing big gestures. Like, what I've noticed about INTJs is they almost always have an economy of motion in their physical realm. And it's because they're taking their energy credits and applying it to this thought. And so if you don't understand how an INTJ's mind is wired, and if the INTJ doesn't understand how other people are wired, like somebody like me is wired to be more cavalier with my physical energetic credits. And so I put a lot more energy into gestures and into my physical space than an INTJ might. And that might seem like a waste of energy to them, because why wouldn't I be applying that to thinking? So it's just a different way of energetic consumption. But let's get into that wiring and really talk about some strategies for, you know, being able to communicate with others and not feel like you're surrounded by people who are not at your level, right? Like, what are some strategies to not feel so lonely? And maybe like what you just talked about, this concept, and I don't think most INTJs think they're surrounded by stupid people. I don't think that that's how they would necessarily phrase that. I would say that they feel like they're surrounded by careless thinkers or people who haven't spent as much time and effort into thought as they have. And that's because they're right. Most people don't spend that much time and effort in that way. And yet there's a reason for that, right? Because people bring different things to the table. So let's talk about how that concept of I'm surrounded by people who aren't as careful in their thinking as I am could be conflated with this idea of I'm not going to allow myself to open up to other people, and that might be why I'm feeling lonely, right? Because these two concepts might be merging together, and the INTJ might blame it or smuggle their loneliness through the filter of nobody else is thinking as clearly as me, so I can't communicate with anyone, which it actually might be it might be more along the lines of a deeper dive into how they're wired and some protective mechanisms that are causing them to feel more lonely. So that might feel a little esoteric, but let's get into what I mean by that. So in order to understand your mental wiring or the mental wiring of people of this type, what we're going to do is we're going to talk about what are technically called cognitive functions. Now, if you've never heard of cognitive functions, if this is the first podcast you've ever heard and you're familiar with Myers-Briggs, but you've never heard that term, cognitive functions are what the system, the Myers-Briggs system, we're really trying to talk about. That four-letter dichotomy, the four letters I for introvert, N for intuitive, T for thinker, J for judger, they're kind of like a decoder ring that is intended to have you understand what those specific functions are that you use for your type. So that's generally the place that we like to live when we're talking about type, is we like to talk about cognitive functions because that's really where, that's the backbone of the entire system, even though it's not very well known. So in order to understand how cognitive functions work, we use a model that we call the CAR model. Now, the CAR model is intended to have you understand your brain as a four-passenger vehicle. And each one of these mental processes take a different position in the car. My recommendation is to go to personalityhacker.com, go check out the blog, put CAR model in the search engine or the search field, and then, you know, read up on what that CAR model looks like for other types and just as a general overview of how the model works. But the way that the CAR model works is that you have a mental process, which is your driver process. And the driver process is what puts you into a flow state. It's mostly how you identify who you are, is through the lens of this mental process. And then next to the driver, you have a co-pilot, which is a support system for the driver. Behind the co-pilot, you have a 10-year-old, which is a less sophisticated part of you. And then behind the driver, you have a 3-year-old, which is the least sophisticated part of you, and what we usually call the blind spot. So for an INTJ, their driver mental process, or what's technically called the dominant cognitive function or way that your brain is wired, is technically named introverted intuition. But we call this perspectives. And the reason why we call it perspectives is that the way that people who use perspectives engage with the world is a little different than the way that most people do. It's a form of being able to watch your mind form patterns, all right? Now, all of us watch our own brains work on some level, right? Like, we can watch our brains form patterns. But introverted intuition or perspectives does this for a really long time, all right? It's doing this as much as it can get away with. It's inside its own mind watching its brain form patterns over extremely long timelines. So it gets a really complex picture of how the mind works in general, because you start to see what we call the pattern of the patterns. Now, if you want a deep dive into how perspectives works, I recommend listening to the podcast called Extroverted Intuition versus introverted intuition, and you'll get a super deep dive into how this process works. But suffice to say, for an INTJ, this means that they're inside their own mind all the time. They're thinking, they're watching their brain form patterns, they're picking up clues as to how other people's minds are forming patterns, and they get a kind of a sixth sense. They start to get this sixth sense of what's going on with other people, and they get this sixth sense about what's coming down, you know, like basically what's coming down the pike. They get an insight into how things work in these super long timelines, which helps them project into the future of what's going to happen next. So it feels very predictive. It feels Cassandra-like. It feels almost like prophecy. Now, obviously, this is not the gift of prophecy, so it's not right 100% of the time. And every person who uses this mental process has to develop the skill of using it. It's a natural talent, but you still have to develop the skill. And the more you develop the skill, the more accurate your predictions become. However, even if you're not developing the skill, you're still probably going to be right more often, you know, than other people of what's coming down the pike. And so people who use this mental process, especially as a driver, as their flow state, they love using this. They love conceptualizing what's going to happen next. They love conceptualizing what's going on with other people. One of my favorite easy to encapsulate descriptions of how this process works is if people who like novelty think outside the box, then people who use perspectives think about the box. It's very much about meaning and understanding and insight.
I would say it's also about meta-perspectiving, seeing the meta on things and understanding how, you know, the narratives and the stories that we tell ourselves and the way we interact with the world are just stories and narratives, and they can be swapped out and they can be like gone up, scaled up to another level, a meta level, to see how they interplay with each other. And you realize, as a perspectives driver, you start to realize the subjective nature of the stories we tell ourselves. And so when you're looking at the world, you understand that people are seeing the same things through different lenses. And you just intuitively get this. This is part of your wiring. You understand that when, and we use the example of when we talk about a teacup, you understand that two people might be talking about a teacup, but one person may have a very different vision of what that looks like in their mind than another person. And you instinctively understand how people are coming to the world and seeing things because you understand how your mind is seeing it, how you're seeing a meta perspective on things, and you're able to work and flow in all of this. Now, for you as an INTJ, this is how you perceive the world. This is how you take in information. This is how you learn about what you're doing in life. And anytime we have a learning process, we also have to balance that out with a way to make decisions in our life. And so as an INTJ, the way that you make your best decisions is by using a process technically called extroverted thinking. We've nicknamed it effectiveness. And this is the co-pilot in your car, that car model we use. And what effectiveness is asking is, what works? What is the bottom line? What will accomplish an objective? I don't care about, you know, if you're making decisions as an INTJ, you may take into account emotions, you may take into account what people think or feel, but you're really concerned about how to accomplish an objective. How does this implement in the real world and get a real result? And what works? And that's the question that effectiveness is asking.
And effectiveness is linear.
Yeah.
It's very much a step-by-step how to get something done. You do this, and then you do this, and then you do this. And when you build chronologically, when you build in a linear progression, you see things take shape over time. You can see how people do project management in this way. Okay, I need you to do this, and I need you to accomplish this next, and then I need you to handle this third. So what's important for effectiveness is that because it's linear, because it's building over time, and because it's about what works and what gets things done, it's very interested in metrics. How do we measure whether or not something is a pass-fail? How do we figure out whether or not this thing is going to get accomplished what we want to accomplish? And so effectiveness takes on a kind of a cold-hearted stance because people's emotions, the way that people feel about it, that might be one component, but it's more of something you have to navigate around as opposed to take into, you know, like you don't incorporate somebody's feeling about a project into the project. It's something you have to deal with and handle so that you can continue the project. So it tends to be it tends to have an interest in building systems that are one size fits all as a general rule. And it wants to get something accomplished. It wants to get something that goes to a pass level.
In order to get something accomplished, everything needs to be broken down in terms of understanding it as a resource. And so effectiveness is very good at breaking things down to their component levels, whether that's a people resource, literally human resources, that's a very effectiveness term, or physical resources, or idea resources, whatever those resources are. Effectiveness is great about lining up things in a linear fashion of accomplishment, utilizing resources at their component level. And it is, in fact, best used when it's not taking into account all the personal feelings that you may have as an INTJ, because that could cloud how you're going to go about accomplishing the task. If you can see things as resource, even people, which sounds counterintuitive to see people as resource, but if you can see people as resource, that enables you to accomplish projects and accomplish things in a fashion that's linear and structured.
Yeah, it's only counterintuitive to you because you're a feeler.
Well, that's true.
I have no problem with seeing people as resources. And I don't think INTJs generally do either.
Absolutely not. But people might. The people that you see as resource might have umbrage with that. They might say, hey, wait a minute here. I'm a real person, dude. What's going on? Why are you treating me this way?
That's totally true. Well, and we're going to get to the human component in a moment because INTJs are not cold. They're a lot less cold than they come across. However, I wanted to just take a moment to marry the two processes we've just talked about together to indicate why INTJs are interested in the things that they're interested in. So if you've got the driver process of perspectives, which loves to see where the puck is going, loves to see way down the line, and then you marry this with effectiveness, which is about pass-fail criteria, metrics, building, implementing strategies, being able to see fruits of your hard work and incorporating systems. When you couple those two things together, then the word that I always think of that sort of encapsulates the INTJ focal point for me is the word sustainability. How do we marry this concept of past fail with way future projection? And that is building systems that last over time. So, you know, when I mentioned before that effectiveness doesn't really care how people feel, and so they want to usually build like a system that's one size fits all. For an INTJ, that isn't necessarily how they use the effectiveness process because they're coupling it with something that recognizes long-term sustainability in context. So an INTJ system, when they're conceptualizing it and thinking about it and planning it out, is generally a little more context-dependent. It takes into account individuals a little bit more because it wants to make sure that those individuals are not going to break the system long term. So INTJs come up with really elegant system solutions for some pretty complex problems, which is why you'll see a lot of INTJs in engineering, you'll see them in think tanks, you'll see them really coming up with these beautiful systems of implementation that's not going to be just a quick fix. It's not going to be just something super short-sighted. It's going to be something that lasts over time. Okay, so the next part of the CAR model is actually something that we're probably going to be referencing a lot in the, you know, the concept of what, you know, hashtag INTJ problems, or a lot of what the feedback that we got in the survey of some of the struggles that an INTJ might have. There's a lot of it that is rooted in the next component of this model, and that is the 10-year-old process in the CAR, or what is technically called your tertiary cognitive function. This is a process that is technically named introverted feeling. If you notice, it's the opposite of the co-pilot, which is extroverted thinking. And we've nicknamed this process authenticity. Now, authenticity, when it's used well, is a decision-making process that checks in with inner alignment. However, at its core base, introverted feeling is all about how things are striking you on an emotional level. How are things impacting you emotionally? So if you can see how that over time, if you grow in sophistication about how things impact you on an emotional level, you could see how you could get to a point where you would recognize, well, things are impacting me as being, you know, bad or wrong because they're not ethical or because this is, you know, this is not right. It becomes a lot about, you know, right and wrong and greater implications philosophically. But it's at a 10-year-old level in the CAR model. So at a 10-year-old level, it's not about deep implications of right and wrong. It's about how things are making you feel, right? Like just how things are making you feel.
Also, I would just add to that, if done well, especially when it's used as a strength, is authenticity mirrors other people's emotions. So we can actually replicate an emotion of what someone else is feeling and mirror it back to them.
Right. And so when done well, it does this in order to understand other people.
Correct.
However, when it's not as sophisticated, it still has this ability to mirror another person's emotional experience, but not in an effort to understand them, but simply how that mirroring process is now affecting the individual, the INTJ.
Yeah.
So for an INTJ, there is a sensitivity that's rooted in this process of introverted feeling, which is the part of them that they believe makes them a sitting duck when it comes to intimacy. Because there is a childlike part of them that can so easily be hurt. There's a childlike part of them that registers every emotion, that registers everything that's coming at them. So if they're not in a good, high quality, highly developed, healthy state of looking at long-term implications and sustainable systems and understanding how they can bring their talent out to the world to build something awesome, if they don't feel qualified for that, if they don't really feel like they're in their co-pilot process of effectiveness enough, then they resort to going to their 10-year-old of authenticity. And that makes them very open to being hurt by other people.
I think a great word here for this is you don't just recognize how things emotionally impact you, you internalize how things emotionally impact you. So it's almost like you've taken it and you've put it into your heart. You've made it part of you. You've let it impact you at a deep emotional level. You've internalized it literally. And it feels so visceral and so real at that level when you internalize an emotion that it can create paralysis. Almost like you feel crippled and unable to move forward because you feel so impacted by this emotional experience that's so internal for you and so subjective and so personal.
Yeah, yeah. And I want to kind of stay here and talk a little bit about how this shows up for an INTJ, because I think a lot of the struggles that an INTJ has is in an over-reliance or an overvaluing of the relationship with this part of them. So one of the things that is interesting about the CAR model is that it fillets out and really describes why we go to our less sophisticated processes, even though that's against, you know, that's kind of counterintuitive based on how we would bring our best foot forward. Why do we go to these backseat passengers at all if they're not our strengths? Well, if you notice when we talked about the technical names of each of these functions or mental processes, the driver process is introverted. And this is actually what makes an INTJ introverted, is that their driver process is introverted. It's introverted intuition. To balance them out, their co-pilot is extroverted. It's extroverted thinking, or what we call effectiveness. There's a reason why one is introverted and one is extroverted. It's because we need to have access to both worlds. We need to be able to understand who we are internally, but we also have to get real world feedback, right? That's what balances us out as human beings. But if you go to the 10-year-old process, it goes back to being introverted. It's introverted feeling. So if an INTJ is in an overly introverted space, if they don't allow themselves to spend enough time outside of their inner world in an outer world context, building things, really focusing on that effectiveness process by getting things done and implementing their ideas in the outside world, not just conceptualizing them, not just planning, but actually building, doing project management, delegating, you know, really inserting themselves into leadership. If they're not doing that, then they're going to rest in on that introverted process of authenticity. And so they're going to be caught in a loop. They're going to be caught in a loop of the ability to see how others see, being able to perspective shift. And then instead of going, okay, I'm going to perspective shift and now use that information to build something that's sustainable for everyone. Instead of that, I'm going to now enter another introverted space of how does that make me feel? Right? So now I can see stuff that maybe other people don't have access to. And then I'm going to integrate, like you just mentioned, Joel, I'm going to integrate that into my emotional space. And that makes them very open to being assaulted, right? Like if you can get inside somebody else's perspective and also get inside their heart and mirror their emotion and then integrate their emotion inside your emotional experience, that means that you're just kind of sitting there waiting for people to project all their stuff onto you. And an INTJ, that is too much for them. They're not a feeler. They're a thinker. And that can become extremely overwhelming. So one of the biggest, I mean, go-to strategies for INTJs is to just shut themselves off, right? To just create all this distance and space between themselves and other people. And I don't even know if they know that that's what they're doing. I think I remember reading an INTJ comment about one of the articles that we wrote. And he said that until he had read, you know, like a portion of what we talked about with this protective mechanism that INTJs can have, he said, I think this is the first time I've ever considered that I haven't really let anybody in. Like I hadn't thought about it, but I don't really think I let people in. So the strategy becomes very unconscious. It's not a conscious decision to not let people in. It's a purely defensive strategy to not allow people to hurt them. And so part of this experience of being lonely, part of this experience of being isolated, they can conflate that with this idea of like not being able to explain where they're coming from and other people just not getting them. They can conflate that with this other, the duality of not really letting anybody in also. And so the combination of these two things makes it so that an INTJ can feel like they're just totally alone in this world. They don't have anybody.
Yeah, human connection, human emotions, human relationships require a level of vulnerability. And vulnerability, I think, is a struggle for you as an INTJ. I think a lot of INTJs, you may have conquered this in your life, but at one point in your life, I think being vulnerable with other people has been a struggle for you. And probably what happened for you, at some point you were vulnerable and someone hurt you and you made a decision, I'm not going to let that happen again. I'm not going to be in a state where I feel out of control. I feel like someone can get to my heart, can step on me, can hurt my heart, can break my heart, and I'm going to just shut myself off and become invulnerable to other people. And I think this is something that is, again, it is a strategy you've employed most likely that helps you with one thing, but then hurts you in the human connection piece, the emotional expressive piece, the connecting with other people part of you.
Yeah, and telling somebody to become vulnerable is so much easier said than done.
Oh, absolutely.
And yet that's the solution. The solution is understanding that you have everything you need within yourself to be able to survive anything. Because it feels like you won't be able to survive it. It feels like if somebody like really worms their way in, the amount of damage that person can do to your heart feels like you won't be able to handle it. And yet there's a resilience to people of this type that I think that they undervalue about themselves. And they do have an ability to survive things. They can feel things deeply, and they can feel things over very long timelines. So it might feel like, you know, it might feel like they can't survive it because it takes a while to get through it. And yet at the same time, like nobody's going to literally break your heart and kill you. That can't happen. And yet at the same time, when you let people in, they can massively add to the quality of your life. So, you know, the risk is worth the reward.
I think one of the important things to remember for you as an INTJ is, you're right, this idea of vulnerability can sound frightening. And I think that it's not just about opening up your heart in general, like just opening up to anyone. I think there's, you know, we talk about that effectiveness process, your co-pilot process. Here at Personality Hacker, we call that your growth position. We really believe that for personal growth, focusing on that secondary co-pilot process will help you become the best version of yourself as an INTJ. And so in order to get to vulnerability, in order to open your heart up and emotionally connect with other people, we believe it's best to route that process through the effectiveness part first in your personality, and then open up that authenticity connection piece for you. So what does that look like? That is basically, effectiveness again is about creating structure, about creating frameworks, about creating systems. And literally we're encouraging you to create systems and frameworks of connection with other people, of being vulnerable. So how would this look in a real world scenario? One scenario we could paint would be you are wanting to connect with people. So you go out to a mixer, maybe a business mixer that you are not hosting. You're just showing up at a business mixer, or you're showing up at a social event and you're connecting with people in real time. This could be a challenge for you as an INTJ because you're now put in a context where you're not in control of the framework of where the meeting takes place. You're not in control of any of the logistics. You are at the mercy of the other people planning the event. And so maybe the lighting or the energy flow of the room might be off, and you don't feel like you have any control over the external framework for the interaction. And this makes you feel vulnerable. You don't want to open up your heart in that context because it's unpredictable. It's not a reliable scenario that you've been put into. However, contrast that with, let's say you wanted a social event where you do the planning. You create maybe a business or social event where you are the one that takes the lead in selecting the restaurant or the pub you meet at, or the building that you meet in. You select the people that are coming. You select how the evening is going to run, or how the event's going to run, the timelines for all of that. You create structure, and now that allows you to rest into the structure you've created using your effectiveness process, and you're able to start opening up the vulnerable part of you that can connect with other people because you know that other stuff is handled.
Yeah, you get to determine why you're there. And so in controlling the context of the event, you get to already weave your vetting processes into the event itself. Like, why are people gathering together? What are their shared interests? What are their shared values? And so by playing the host, and by the host, I think what you're talking about, Joel, is not just being, you know, the person who spears the pickles with the toothpicks. You're talking about actually creating a, you know, like the reason why people are gathering to begin with. So you already have your first line of vetting, and the context itself can help you. I think actually a lot of people who are effectiveness can relax into a situation that they have control over when they know that it's their event that they're running. And that might feel overwhelming as an INTJ, especially if you haven't put yourself out there in that way. And yet this is a much better situation than to come in and wait for people to come to you and wait for people to talk to you or feel maybe awkward about approaching another person that you don't know. Like when you're the host, you're now the highest status person in the room because you're the host. You're the person who put everything together. So you automatically, you know, create a sense of status. You automatically create a sense of belonging and you get to determine why people are showing up. And so you've positioned yourself in a way that makes it so that you're a lot less of a sitting duck. And I think when people are in that situation, there's a sense of calm that they can get, a sense of comfort that an INTJ can experience in that situation, which allows them to be more free and open, which allows them to be more open to connecting with other people and not feel as out of control of the situation.
So as an INTJ listening, I'm sure you can say, okay, that's nice and dandy. If I had the ability to create, you know, a business meeting or a social event where I got to show up and be the one that designed it all. But what if I do have to go and engage in an environment where I don't have full control? Well, I think one of the things, again, is to use that effectiveness process to get as much control in the situation as possible. I remember working for a CEO at a company that I worked for, a nonprofit, a while back. He was probably an INTJ. He may have been an ISTJ, but I believe he was an INTJ. He just felt like he was intuitive primary. And I think one of the things that he was in a business context, and I was watching him work the room. And I remember pulling him aside later another day and asking him a question. I said, how do you manage all the people coming at you and asking things of you? You seem like you're able to connect with them, but not let them just hijack your time. It doesn't feel like I didn't use the word vulnerable, but basically I was saying, how do you not allow yourself to be vulnerable? And he said, well, if you noticed, I always have my executive assistant with me when I'm in social situations like that. And if I start to sense a tension or something that I'm uncomfortable with, or I see my time and resource getting taken from me, I'll turn and I'll use my executive assistant to change the energy of the conversation and direct the person, delegate the conversation to my executive assistant that's with me, and then move away from that conversation and go on to the next thing I need to do. And then the executive assistant, once they're done finishing that, will follow me again and I'll be able to engage with people. So I have a structure in place to enable me to feel more in control of the situation when it feels out of hand emotionally for me. And I thought that was now this is in a business context. What if you're not in a business context? What if you are in a social setting? You have to go somewhere. Well, maybe you have a wife or a husband that could serve this role for you, someone that could help facilitate conversation or the logistics of conversation. Maybe a friend would go with you or a colleague. So there are ways to potentially leverage a system, even if it's a very small system, just having another person present that can help you manage, structurally manage, using effectiveness again, this idea of resource management and delegation, to control and be able to create containers around your social interactions.
Yeah. I think also what you're saying brings up for me just a general feeling for INTJs. Like if they have a feeling like they're out of control, that's when they clamp down the most. That's when they feel the most like a sitting duck. And I wrote about this in an article about INTJs that I've actually heard them say things like, I'm going to work on my social, you know, like I'm going to work on my social systems or like the people that I'm hanging out with or whatever. I'm going to work on my social world after I get my business stuff handled, after I'm making the money that I want to make. And I think this is a product of effectiveness in the sense that effectiveness is linear and goes step by step. But I think it's an over-reliance on this concept that one thing has to be handled before the next thing can be attended to. And I think when an effectiveness person in general feels good, like they have systems in place where they don't feel like somebody could call them out on that they don't have their business stuff handled, or they don't, you know, they don't feel like they're in a less than or lower status position, I think the INTJ is a lot more open to experiencing closer relationships. So I don't believe that like one thing needs to get handled and the next thing can get handled. I think that they can be built simultaneously. And at the same time, if you're not building enough resource in the outside world, if you're not implementing enough effectiveness strategies just in general in your life, you're going to feel more and more vulnerable in a bad way. You're going to feel like you're a sitting duck. So to get your social stuff handled, make sure that you're working on your secular stuff. Make sure you're working on building systems and strategies in your life, that you are building something with a purpose, that you are seeing results for your hard work, that you are in a business context or a job or career context that makes you feel fulfilled. The less you feel fulfilled, the less you feel like you're really being used to the best of your ability, the less likely you are going to be to open yourself up to another person, because you're going to feel just in general vulnerable and you're going to be in general exposed in a sitting duck. So make sure that you're not allowing yourself to have in any context of feeling that you're being wasted. And there's a lot of different strategies to do that. But number one is get yourself out of your comfort zone and get into action. Get yourself out of your comfort zone of being reliant on whatever it is that you think is making you feel invulnerable, but actually might be kind of jacking you up, because this is a strategy that has a double-edged sword. Make sure that you're allowing yourself to get out of your comfort zone and work for that promotion, or work for that, you know, that starting that business or whatever it is, and start to see fruits for your hard labor. If you feel good in that context, it's going to spill out over into your social world, and you're going to be a lot more open to being vulnerable. It's just how the psychology works. It's just how the relationship between effectiveness and authenticity, that's just how it works for an INTJ.
Yeah, the emotion you're working with here is you want to swap the emotion of feeling invulnerable and protected with the emotion of feeling empowered. And that empowered feeling comes from building things in the external world. It comes from structuring things. It comes from getting outside of yourself and putting things into action. That will make you feel empowered, and that will give you the feeling of, okay, I can handle this. And that feeling of not wanting to be vulnerable will start to fade away, because you're going to know you've got this structurally. You've got this handled.
Yeah, you just said that 1,000 times better than the way that I just said it. One more thing I want to mention before we move on from this 10-year-old position, or the 10-year-old function of authenticity, and making sure that you're not, as an INTJ, staying too much in that authenticity process. Another component of authenticity is, even when it's used well, even when it's healthy, it's a very idealistic process, because it's calibrating to how things are subjectively making you feel. And so there's not really a lot of like check in with how reality is working in the outside world. It's more a conviction or a sense of, you know, like it's like, this is how I'm relating to the situation, and this is how I want to be relating to the situation. This is what should be. Yeah, exactly. This is how things should be making me feel, and this is what should be in the outside world. So it's very idealistic. And when people have this as a strength, that can be, you know, that's a very Joan of Arc way of going about life. It's like, let's implement the things that should be implemented regardless of how many mountains are in the way. However, when it's a 10-year-old process, again, we're talking about something a little less sophisticated and not something that's supposed to be a prime mover for you. So the way it shows up for an INTJ is that, again, hashtag INTJ problems, it shows up in that perfectionism that tends to be a running theme for INTJs, because it's an idealization of what should be. And because it's going back to the self-referencing component of yourself, right? You're staying introverted. You're not checking in with the outside world using extroverted thinking. You're defaulting to introverted feeling or authenticity. Because it maintains a self-referencing space, this idealism gets turned in on the INTJ themselves. They have a sense of perfectionism or how things should be based on themselves. And this can be crippling for the INTJ, because the opposite of this is effectiveness, which is a pass-fail mechanism, right? It's like, done is better than perfect is a very much an effectiveness statement, right? Like, is it working? Is it a good prototype? Can it be implemented? Can we just get it done and move on to the next thing? Great, let's do it. That's how effectiveness thinks. Authenticity is, does it resonate with me? Does it make me feel good? Does it make me feel like it should, you know, that things are the way they should be? So when an INTJ focuses too much on that authenticity piece, it means that nothing is ever quite good enough, because things should be perfect. And again, this is also a defensive position. This prevents the INTJ from having to force themselves into uncomfortable situations, because they're waiting for just the right time. They're waiting for just that perfect moment. They're waiting for something ideal to happen in order to implement. And that's going the wrong direction. You never want to use effectiveness as a servant to authenticity. You never want to wait for that perfect moment in order to act. it's the opposite. You want to be acting, and while you're acting, if something strikes you as not authentic to you, or something strikes you as unethical, then you change tactic. But authenticity should always be serving effectiveness, not the opposite. And I think that authenticity position, defaulting to it, not wanting to go to effectiveness because that forces you out of your shell. It forces you to get out into the outside world, which might not be as comfortable. It's so easy to default to authenticity. But there are so many problems when authenticity becomes your primary way of determining what to do, what action to take, how you should feel about things. There are so many problems when you use it as your navigator. So again, I just want to reiterate that oftentimes for an INTJ, the solution is to get back into that effectiveness process, to get back into extroverted thinking, and use pass-fail metrics, use getting into action, use implementation, and be able to see the results, right? The hard work that you put into perspectives and effectiveness by conceptualizing way better than anybody else does, by thinking long and hard, by taking lots of time to be very careful and rigorous in your thinking. Effectiveness turns those concepts into realities. And then you can start vetting them. You can start to see if, yeah, this was a great idea, or no, that was actually a really crappy idea. And I never knew until I actually implemented. And that relationship between your driver and co-pilot will afford, you know, give you that opportunity. You'll really be able to see your quote unquote mistakes of commission versus your mistakes of omission. Mistakes of commission are fantastic. It means you've learned something. It means that you can now implement better next time. It's that whole fail again, fail better. You're able to do that if you're actually implementing. But if you're waiting for that ideal time, or you're waiting for the perfect moment, or until your idea is perfect, well, you're just going to be in continual waiting mode. And you'll never be able to see the fruits of your hard labor. You'll never be able to see whether or not your concept was solid. And you'll never be able to implement those sustainable systems that you so desire to see in the world.
I want to mention one last piece of your car model, because I think this last piece also has an impact on you. It's your blind spot. We believe that this mental process has developed to about a three-year-old child's level. The technical name for this mental process is extroverted sensing, and we've nicknamed it sensation. It's all about real-time kinetic connection with your environment. It's about seeing the world as it is right now in this moment. It's not about what perspectives is about with perspective shifting. It's about seeing things from an individualized perspective right now in the here and now. Oftentimes, if this is a strength for someone in their personality, they're an athlete or a musician, they're very tied in with their physical senses, their five senses and the other senses they have of balance and taste and touch or sensations inside their bodies, things of this nature. So this process is a three-year-old for you, and oftentimes this can really be a blind spot. Oftentimes you'll end up going here as an INTJ when you're overly stressed. That perspectives process is stressed out. You may not really even recognize yourself when you go to this place. And it can hijack you randomly in your life, where all of a sudden you might have a craving for a substance, or maybe overindulging in some type of, you know, sensory behavior, whether that's overeating or too much sexual activity or unhealthy behaviors that are indulging the physicality of your body. And this, again, is your blind spot. And I think it's worth mentioning, we won't spend a lot of time on it, but I do believe this is something that can trip you up as an INTJ and something to be aware of and to watch out for, because this can be something that can hijack your happiness. And also, when it gets in tandem with that authenticity piece, they can gang up together and really cripple you from moving forward in some ways.
Yeah, if you look at the three-year-old and the 10-year-old, they're massively indulgent for an INTJ when they go to these spaces. One is physical sensory indulgence, and the other one is emotional indulgence. And so for an INTJ, really the thing that they have to monitor themselves for is whether or not they're going to an overly indulgent space. And one of the best ways to create a relationship with that three-year-old process of sensation, instead of being physically indulgent, is to be physically aware, to be checking in with your body to find out what it needs, to be taking care of it. It's really easy for an INTJ to see the body as just like a vehicle for the brain, right? Like all your body does is it really transports your brain around. And that's not exactly accurate. Your body is extremely important. And there's a lot of, I mean, if you want to look at it this way, your brain actually extends into your body. I think we've mentioned this in previous podcasts, but they found neurons in your stomach and in your heart, indicating that your brain actually extends, like the neurons, the brain cells actually extend into your body. So the whole, there's not as clean a line between those two pieces as we have previously thought. So if you want a good relationship with your three-year-old, make it so that you're not being physically indulging it like the three-year-old that wants to eat too many cookies out of the cookie jar, but rather checking in with it and making sure that you're nourishing your body and taking care of it through, you know, healthy exercise, through high quality foods, you know, just getting, making sure you're getting enough sleep. Make sure that you're treating your body with honor as opposed to just seeing it as, you know, as a vehicle you can swap out later.
So that's the car model. That's how your mind is wired as an INTJ. That's how you learn information. That's how you make decisions. This is the underpinning of your mind and how you show up to the world. Let's switch gears a little bit and talk about some of the challenges that were reported by INTJs on the survey. Just quickly, one of the first challenges was from a lot of INTJ women who said, look, I'm an INTJ woman and I feel like other women don't want to connect with me. I don't feel connected to other women. And I feel like men are either intimidated by me or uninterested. I don't feel a connection with men either. I feel lost and I feel like neither gender wants to connect with me as an INTJ woman.
We actually did a podcast on thinker women and feeler men. I don't remember exactly which podcast number it was, but we did actually a whole podcast on some of the phenomenon that comes from that. Because statistically, like more women are feelers than thinkers. I think it's 75% of women are feelers and only 25% are thinkers. And the disparity is a little smaller for men. I think it's more like a 55-45 split, with 55% of men being thinkers and 45% being feelers. So when a man is a feeler, I think it's more like he's got to come up against stereotypes, like masculine stereotypes. But I think for women, it's less about stereotypes, although that can show up for them too. And it's more about like, yeah, they just legitimately are wired differently. Like there's a legit difference in wiring than the majority of women that they're going to hang out with.
Well, and that same wiring, you know, there's a lot of triggers. If you're a heterosexual female INTJ, a lot of men that would be attracted to you are looking for certain markers of personality and femininity that they've, you know, culturally stuck in their head. That may not be true in any sense of the word, but that's what they're looking for in some way on a surface level. So this idea of you being wired differently than women, and then, you know, men are maybe looking for certain markers and you may not feel like you meet those markers. It can be confusing for you. Like, why is this happening? I think one of the things, again, going back to what we talked about before, this idea of creating a container and being the person that is the facilitator of the social interaction, whether that's on a really micro scale, like having somebody there to help you in that social engagement, or, you know, structuring the actual event itself on the really high level, like leadership portion of it. Both of these techniques, I believe, would help you as an INTJ female set up conditions to where you feel empowered in the moment. You have a structural advantage. You're looking for, you know, I think effectiveness always thinks in terms of competitive advantage. This is a phrase I think that effectiveness loves. And you want to create a competitive advantage. That sounds so like cold-hearted or whatever. You want to create a competitive advantage when you're connecting with other people, when you're connecting with other women, when you're connecting with men. And that competitive advantage is making sure you feel empowered, make sure you have a container, make sure you're showing up as a facilitator or a host or a hostess. And I don't mean, again, just like Antonio said, it's not about putting like toothpicks in the olives and laying out a table spread. It's more about the structure of the engagement. And I think, again, I think you as an INTJ can take what we just said about this, these two ideas in social engagement. I think you can start letting this simmer in that perspectives process. And you're going to come up with a bunch of practical ideas for you as an INTJ that you can implement in your life that's contextual to you. Because we could talk about a bunch of ideas on our end here specifically, but each person's unique and different. And the structure for you is going to be very different than the structure for another INTJ.
I would like to make a comment, though, that my observation has been that when you are not what you mentioned before, that there may be this idea that there's an imprint about what women are supposed to look like and an INTJ doesn't fit that imprint. I've noticed as an ENTP woman that when you are what I call a bird of paradise, which means that you are different than the norm, yeah, you're probably not going to attract like a higher percentage of people. However, the percentage of people for which you are their imprint, they're looking for you. They can't find you. They're looking for somebody just like you everywhere. So one of the best ways to attract those people, and I'm talking about not just romantically, I'm also talking about friendship-wise, you know, platonic relationships. There are people who you are their imprint. Friendship, you're their imago, you are the person that they're looking for. And if you haven't run into those people yet, it's because you're not in the right places. You need to be willing to put yourself out there more, position yourself, find people who have shared interests, like go to events, go to seminars, go to cons, go to whatever it is that's interesting to you, and you will run into those people because they are looking for you and they just can't find you when you're at home.
Yeah, and that's another way you can be structurally in charge of your experience is choosing the places you decide to spend time, choosing the places you decide to go to. I think that's a great point. And I think that you as an INTJ woman, if you decide leveraged places to go and leveraged ways to put yourself out there, not just willy-nilly, don't just be a crazy extrovert, but be strategic about where you end up, I think that's going to pay off dividends for you as an INTJ.
I think one last thing that I'd like to mention before we wrap this podcast up is this idea of patience. In the survey over and over, people talked about how patience was difficult for them because, you know, they hated being doubted. They hated being second-guessed. They hated other people, like having to explain things to another person if the other person isn't getting it. There was this sense of not having patience for other people. And I think the root of a lot of that goes back to that perfectionism we mentioned before, which is that I don't think INTJs have a lot of patience for themselves. I think that concept of rigor that they have in thought translates over into the concept of rigor as to their own expectations of themselves. It comes back to that idealization of how things should be. And one of the best ways to make space for others and have more patience for others is to start, quote unquote, at home, is to have more patience for yourself. Remove this concept of idealization. Remove this concept of having a strong idea of what should be reality and how you should be showing up and how you should be presenting, right? Like all this almost romanticism around who you should be, and rest into effectiveness, which is, yeah, but you're going to go get it done anyway. Done is better than perfect. Present your, you know, go, be willing to make mistakes. Be willing to fail spectacularly. Be willing to allow your ego to die a little bit. And be willing to, you know, basically be the kind of person who actually gets things done as opposed to conceptualize getting things done. And in that process, you'll be able to be more patient with yourself. You'll learn self-patience, and that will translate into patience with other people.
If you're an INTJ listening, we're recommending something that sounds like it will be wasting energy for you. By getting outside and by implementing things in the outside world, you will by definition be wasting some energy. You'll be burning more energy than you would like to. You've been developing strategies your entire life to conserve energy, to conserve resource, to conserve the amount of movement and the amount of expenditure of that energy. And I would encourage you that the strategy of trying to preserve your energy holistically and sustaining that energy management over time may be the thing that's really holding you back. It's going to be wasteful. When you get into this effectiveness process, you're going to see that you have some false starts. You have some things that failed. Solutions weren't as elegant as you projected them to be. Things are going to break. Things aren't going to work out in the real world like your mind thinks they should work out. And it's going to get frustrating, and you're going to get tempted to go back inside and conserve energy again. And I think our encouragement to you would be push through that. Realize that there's going to be some energy spillage. Realize that that's part of implementing. You have some waste. You have some burn off. You have some of this stuff that happens. Do it anyway. And you're going to see over time that when you begin to test iterate in the real world, determine what works, begin implementing even before you feel like you're ready, even before you feel like you want to expend that energy, you're going to get such great feedback from the outside world. Your ideas and your projections, each time you do this, when you take an idea projection and then you implement it, all that feedback you get about what actually works is going to only make your projections and your theories and your ideas even stronger going forward. So really what you're doing is giving a gift to your future self. So what do you think? You've been an INTJ listening, or you're somebody that knows an INTJ in your life, and we'd love to hear feedback from you. You can leave feedback over on our website, personalityhacker.com, directly below this podcast. We'd love to hear your thoughts. You're here part of this conversation. We want to have you part of this conversation. You can also tie in with our community of like minds, people just like you, that want to grow themselves, understanding their personality and other models of human development. You can find our community over at facebook.com/personalityhacker. You can also find us at twitter.com/personalityhack. We're on a bunch of other social media platforms of your choice. You can engage with us there as well, but those are the two primary places. And we'd love to have you stop by, like the page, and be a part of this community together.
We've also started a new community on Facebook called Intuitive Awakening, so please feel free to find us there. And if you like what you heard, please subscribe to our podcast and share it with somebody else. We would also love to get your feedback on iTunes. Now, we discovered recently that iTunes will highlight podcasts on their front main page if they get a lot of ratings and reviews that are positive. So if you'd like to do something, if you'd like to give back, maybe you're not in a position right now to, you know, purchase a program or to support the community in another way, but you'd love to support us, please stop by iTunes and give us a rating and review. You can also do that on various Android platforms, but the high leverage rating review is iTunes for really getting the message out.
Absolutely. So my name is Joel Mark Witt.
And I'm Antonia Dodge.
And we can't wait to talk with you on the next Personality Hacker Podcast.